Visual effects can be complicated. Even just the terminology can be very intimidating if you aren't familiar with it. So we thought we would take a quick dive into some common VFX terms that would be very helpful to know. Now, a lot of these are very 101, most of them are, so you might already be acquainted with all of the above. This is really just for our beginners. So let's jump right into our first term, which is compositing or comping, which is the process of combining multiple layers together to create one new overall final image or shot. This technique has existed for decades, and really the idea started in camera using various techniques, but of course these days it's all handled digitally in post-production. And essentially, every effect we're going to be mentioning in this episode links to compositing in some way, as they are different techniques used to get your final end result. And that brings us right to our next term, which is keying. Green screen or blue screen chroma keying is one of the most well-known effects people are generally aware of. Even people with no interest in filmmaking have likely seen behind-the-scene footage or images of a number of movies showing an actor in front of a green screen or green bodysuit wearing stand-ins. And for decades, chroma keying has been used for everyday things like the weather map on your local news. It is the process of keying out or removing a certain color to create an area of alpha in the frame, which will allow other layers to show through these areas of the footage and composite together. A common misconception is that green screening or keying is a simple click of a button. While it can be an easy effect to do if you have a very smooth keyable color, there often can be hours worth of work to create the perfect key, especially when finer details such as hair or liquid are in the scene. Keying also doesn't have to be a specific green or blue. These colors are most frequently used because they are the furthest away from the human skin tone, but any color can be keyed, like we showed in last week's episode. It's also not uncommon for green screen work in big feature films to end up being rotoed manually anyway. You can often see small areas of a frame has a backdrop for keying, whereas the rest would still need to be rotoed, which does take us to rotoscoping. This is possibly one of the most hated jobs of post-production because of how time-consuming and monotonous it can be. Rotoscoping is manually cutting out parts of a layer or footage, again, for compositing with other layers beneath it. Essentially, a green screen key without the green screen. It originally began with editors and artists physically cutting around elements of an actual frame of film and stitching that together with another frame, the analog version of what we do today. Now, thankfully, it is all handled digitally, but it still requires cutting around the moving points on multiple frames for moving objects or characters in order to extract them from the footage. And even more thankfully, we now have tools such as Rotobrush and After Effects, which handle most of the work for us. And although it is a massive pain, there are many benefits and logistical reasons for opting to rotoscope rather than using a green or blue screen. One of the main ones being lighting. When using a chroma backdrop, you really want as much even lighting as possible, and if you are in a small space or shooting outdoors at night, this can become very difficult. For instance, we have been asked why we rotoed rather than using a green suit for this effect in our Conjuring effects episode. The main reason was because of the green suit in this dark lighting would have been too dark and unevenly lit to be keyable. So it made a lot more sense to manually roto and have Emily wearing a similar color outfit to the sheet so that there also wouldn't be green color spill. Our friends over at Corridor Crew recently released a video looking into a new AI rotoscoping technique, which looks really promising, and I'm sure we're gonna see a lot more of that in the future. Next, we have paint outs and removals. This relates to when objects or parts of a frame are digitally painted out or removed so that they no longer are visible within your shot. The most common use of this is removing wires for stunts. This is a technique that I've used a ton for the show and my short films, which is more often than not an effect used to remove film equipment, crew members, or distracting areas. Like this shot Ryan Wellborn did for Ballistic. He borderline replaced half the shot for me. Basically, anything which could break the illusion and take the audience out of the moment. These are often referred to as invisible effects, which are effects that don't call attention to themselves and are meant to never be seen. A great example of this are the tire tracks that were removed from this shot in the film 1917. Another kind of painting, which is also totally different, is a matte painting. This is another technique that has been around for a very long time and used to be something that was physically painted on a clear surface by incredible artists to enhance enhance a film's visuals. It's had great effects in building out fantasy and sci-fi worlds or time period settings, which otherwise would have been impossible. A famous version of this that definitely got around on the internet is this great shot from Charlie Chaplin's film Modern Times. The idea is that this extension is painted on a clear surface that is placed perfectly in front of the camera to match the perspective. These days, it's a very common effect done digitally for extending sets or placing locations in different areas. It can even be used subtly, such as changing seasons with different elements, or drastically to completely transport you to a different scene. And in a way, a sky replacement fits into this category, or at least a very similar category. They are just as common, if not more so, and they subtly or drastically change a shot, whether it be for continuity, mood, or to change season or time of day. And speaking of time of day, our next term is day for night, which is exactly what it sounds like, shooting during the day with the intent to make the final scene appear to exist at night. This can both be done on set practically with no need for visual effects at all by doing things like blacking out the windows and using different lighting techniques to give the sense of night, like we did in my short film Tell and these scenes from Ballistic. But then there are the shots that do rely on VFX to change the time of day in post. This can be one of those effects which can often be very obvious and distractingly fake, but there's plenty that work really well. It really just comes down to a combination of cinematography, VFX, and potentially even weather to help land that realistic end result. Now we have an extremely obvious one, and that's assets. Assets are files, usually digital video files, which are composited into a scene. Fire, smoke, dust, explosions, blood, and muzzle flashes are all very common to see. And while they can be done practically on set, choosing digital assets instead is frequently used and often reliable option when it isn't possible to do practically during production. For instance, in my short film Ballistic, we had moments of practical fire and explosions where we could have them, but there were several shots where it just wasn't possible due to our budget and overall restrictions, so we did it in post, which, other than Ballistic, that's how I've had to do it in every film because we didn't have the budget or the people to pull it off practically. And like most things, these can look great or terrible depending on the assets themselves, the skills of the artist, or, as we've all been victim to, the time given to complete that shot. Assets can also be for non-practical effects such as sci-fi and magic effects. There are multiple companies who create and sell really great assets like Video Copilot, Action VFX, and of course, we have some on our store Triune Digital. And if you don't want to buy them, you can create your assets yourself, which is always nice to create something custom with the specific intention of ending up in the shot in question. You can use chroma, black, or white backdrops to film things such as fire, smoke, or dust to use in your own projects. Just make sure you do it safely and never do anything with pyro without the assistance of a licensed professional. But again, if you don't feel like making your own and you need some, definitely check out our store. We have a ton of different assets like lens effects, dust, smoke, shockwaves, slime, sci-fi weapons, energy, and a lot more. We have more assets on there too, like royalty-free music, LUTs, sound effects, courses, and a bunch more. So check out the links in the notes if you're interested. But moving on again, we have another 101 and widely known term, and that is CGI, or computer generated imagery, which is the use of computer graphics to create images in a wide variety of different mediums, such as video games, commercials, computer animation, visual effects for film, and so on. But CGI really is a whole other world with so many terms such as sculpting, modeling, rigging, animating, UVs, simulation, physics, and so much more that it's too much to really cover in one episode. But one specific term that we will talk about today is also our last term, and that is passes. Passes are essentially multiple layers of a render which are ultimately combined to create a final look. With CG, a render can be split into individual passes to allow greater control over each aspect when they are being composited. For instance, you can have a pass for diffuse, reflections, illuminations, lighting, depth, and more. These are then recombined to create a final version, a process involving compositing. Again, we realize this is 101 stuff that a lot of you already know, but a lot of questions have been asked, which led us to want to make this episode. Plus, for people that aren't visual effects artists, but do work with them, like directors and producers, understanding this stuff just a little bit more is always really helpful for both parties. But that's it for today. If you have something that you want to see us cover, let us know in the comments below. And if you aren't, consider subscribing. And if you do, make sure you hit the bell to be notified whenever we release new content. And until next week, don't forget to write, shoot, edit, repeat.